asking people for, you know, what's your password? And if that's all you need to get into an organization, game over. Eventually, of course, the hacking pressure will be high enough for everyone to have been pushed into hardware tokens, kind of a split brain that you have to go through a specific gateway. Welcome back to Hacking Matters. I'm Carsten, and we're discussing the second part of social engineering resilience. Last week, we looked at the human, the psychology side of how criminals mess with mostly our subconscious, and how through training, we can perhaps encourage some hero actions to make that more difficult. But in the end, hackers will find a way to influence individuals, and we have to assume that they can trick humans into doing insecure things. Today we're looking at the other side of social engineering resilience, technology. And if the human firewall and the technology come together, we can achieve better than average social engineering resilience. And that's really the goal here, to be better than average so that hackers go somewhere else. We'll talk through two areas in which technology make a big difference. One is strongly authenticating individuals. The other one is providing the right level of access to those individuals. Let's start with authentication. The traditional authentication methods, typing in a username and a password, is clearly outdated. Phishing, vishing, smishing, all of these techniques have an easy time asking people for, you know, what's your password? And if that's all you need to get into an organization, game over. So for a long time, organizations have added multi-factor authentication. You used to have these RSA keychains, then SMS text messages. Today, apps on Android phones and iPhones, the top-notch technology these days. Hardware, again, keychains, coming back almost to RSA days, but ones that you plug into your computer and that talk directly through your computer through an encrypted channel with whatever you're trying to authenticate against. All of these options are still available today. And there's, of course, a hierarchy in security. Passwords by themselves are clearly not secure enough. They're vulnerable to any kind of social engineering, and also the passwords can be traded on and on and on because they remain valid for a long time. One step up, receiving a text message on your phone is insecure in many ways, but much more secure than just using the password, because if somebody steals the password, at least it's not valid for longer than this one session, after which they can't just trade it on until somebody eventually finds a way to abuse your account. So if there's no other options, text message-based authentication is still better than just using a password. Why text message is considered insecure? Number of reasons. Outdated technology, obviously. For instance, SS7 can divert text messages to somebody else. We had a recent episode on that. SIM swapping for higher value targets. Let's say you have a big crypto wallet or big bank account. People might just walk into your telco operator's shop, pretend they're you, and get a copy of your SIM card, thereby receiving all your text messages. Might be vulnerable to certain configuration settings on your phone where you can allow apps to read text messages. That, of course, is insecure. So text messages are the weakest form of multi-factor authentication and still better than nothing. One step up are apps that allow you to receive a notification on your phone to click yes, or apps that generate a number code that you then type into the website. Often it's the same app providing both options. These two options come with very different security trade-offs though. If the website sends a notification to your phone for you to just click yes, hackers can exploit this using what in the industry we call multi-factor authentication fatigue, MFA fatigue, where they keep sending you authentication requests and users apparently think something is wrong in the system and they keep clicking whatever they can click for it to go away, and eventually they'll click the OK button just trying to make it stop, and it does stop. So it's very convenient, but it can be insecure. Whilst using the same app, but having to type a number into a website is slightly more secure because it actually forces you to know where you're logging into. Now, neither of these, though, is actually social engineering resilient, because the social engineers who are asking you to type in your password might as well ask you to type in your MFA number or click OK at the right moment. So careful with both of them. Just like text messages, they are step up, in fact, one step beyond text messages, because SS7 attacks, SIM swapping doesn't work, but they're still not social engineering resilient. Most users are on that level of security these days, because the next step up is quite a logistical overhead, having to provide USB tokens to everyone who wants to authenticate against your system, and then of course have some kind of a recovery process for when people lose their USB tokens. Typically that's only done for the highest value users, sysadmins for instance, some programmers perhaps, maybe people in management who have access to financial data, but not everyone gets these USB tokens. What makes the USB tokens more secure than alternatives is that they are phishing resilient, in that the USB token speaks directly to the authentication server. And if there were a phisher in between, it wouldn't authenticate. It would refuse because the phisher can't authenticate to the USB token. So it creates mutual trust rather than just you telling a website that's possibly a phisher's website your multi-factor credentials. You see how there's an arms race going on, and hackers become better and better at exploiting the lower tiers of this authentication technology hierarchy. And yet, I think we have reached a point, again in history, we've been there before, where authentication technology can be considered good enough in this arms race right now. And you see this by the hackers going after the authentication technology itself. This previous moment in time was 2011, where there was a famous hack at RSA, which signaled that the hackers basically thought that technology at clients was difficult to circumvent, so you have to hack the technology provider directly to gain access. That hack was successful back then, but it showed that the hackers had to go to the technology provider, that the technology as it was deployed was considered secure enough. The same is happening right now with hackers going after companies like Okta providing authentication technology. If their technology was weaker, they wouldn't have to go to the root and try to exploit it there. So with authentication, we have reasonably secure choices in the market right now, but we have to keep observing this arms race, because eventually, of course, the hacking pressure will be high enough for everyone to have been pushed into hardware tokens. There is technologies right now where every phone, every laptop is becoming such a hardware token. It still doesn't solve the problem of replacement when you're losing your phone or your entire laptop, but it does make the technology much easier to roll out. Everyone already has a phone or a laptop, so we will see more hardware embedded and thereby phishing resilient authentication rolled out to pretty much everyone in the future. The second technology aspect we want to talk about is access right segregation, basically making sure that accounts that are possible victims of social engineering are not the same accounts that access your crown jewels. If you look around your organization, there are some individuals that have super user access. System administrators, for instance, domain admins in Active Directory, as an example. They have access to pretty much everything they want to access. But these same individuals also need to read emails, need to browse the web, do all kinds of things that could possibly make them the target of social engineering. So how do you distinguish that? Well, by giving them two different accounts. One, their black account, from most laptops being black traditionally, and their black account is just a normal corporate account accessing emails, browsing the internet and whatnot. And then there's a completely separate account that sometimes people actually use from a different laptop, a red laptop, only for privileged actions. So there's no chance of browsing the internet, clicking on a phishing website link, on an email. Any of those are precluded. They could only happen on the black account, not on the red account. So this leverages two things. One, of course, the technology segregation. Some things just can't flow from one laptop to another. But it also leverages what we discussed last week, that there is a fast subconscious thinking and a slow conscious thinking in the human mind. And when using the red laptop, you're very aware that everything you're doing is dangerous, potentially dangerous. So you do this slow and considerate. whilst all your routine tasks, the whole clicking around the corporate websites, that you do on the laptop that allows you to perhaps switch to this faster mode and doing things more subconsciously. So by having this access segregation into a black and a red laptop, you have a technology barrier, but you also leverage human psychology. Now, not everyone actually has two different laptops. In fact, that's relatively rare, but there is an equivalent that achieves almost the same objectives whilst not doubling on the hardware. And that technology is called privileged access management, where you introduce an additional boundary from your black laptop. You're accessing the privileged access management, and only through that can you take privileged actions. So there is a barrier that signals to you, be aware of your actions now, be consciously aware, be slow about it, and that also provides a technology boundary. What's behind the privileged access manager can't just access the internet, access your emails. So you can have this from one laptop, but kind of a split brain by having your normal actions on the enterprise network that everyone can access, and then this privileged access area that you have to go through a specific gateway. This works really well with zero trust, where anyway, you want to push your authentication points closer to your critical assets. And one such authentication point can be a privileged access management, which basically sits in front of all the RDPs to your domain controllers or your SSH ports into your Linux servers. So there you have it, combating social engineering using psychology from last week and technology from this week, specifically strong authentication, eventually hardware-based, until then some sensible usage of apps, and access segregation through separated hardware or at the very least through a privileged access barrier that keeps the world separate. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, show it with a like and subscribe. Any questions, go below as well. And until next week, happy hacking.